What side am I on? What side am I supposed to be on? I never know.
Bam! What's up tonight? How's everybody doing? Don Barry is here in spirit. Tom is here. AH is here. And seven other people hiding in the back room. And that's okay. That's okay to hide in the back room tonight. How you guys doing? But I've got a lot of stuff going on, a lot of news going on, a lot of things that we're going to chat about tonight. Some changes we're going to do. Yo. And we're going to get started here quickly. Changed the studio. I'm gutting the studio out. I started and I was like, okay, this is too big a deal just for today. That was yesterday. So it's still different. It's going to be different. It's going to be way different when I get done. So I've decided I'm going to get into that. Adjust some stuff out, change some stuff out. Gonna bring some weird stuff in. I know you guys hardly believe that I'd make changes. I live for secret locations, Kim. And there's the Cookie Monster. Yum, 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 Cookie Monster. Ha, ha, ha. So, a lot of you guys know that that I like Joe Rogan. I like watching his podcast. I like the interesting people that he has on. And he was talking about Alpha Brain, and I thought, Alpha Brain, man, lately, I don't know about you guys. I know we're at a level most of us are probably looking in the fourth quarter. I hate to say it like that. Not all of us, but some of us. Everybody's in the half at halftime. But a couple of us are going into the fourth quarter. And, you know, man, I just been having trouble remembering stuff. And it's like, man, where did I put that? And, you know, I've got a pair of glasses on my head looking for my glasses. And I'm like, okay. So when he suggested that we take Alpha Brain. Now, I wish I was sponsored by Alpha Brain, but I'm definitely not. More black lights is correct, sir. We're gonna go crazy in the back. It's going to be another planet. So I bought this last week, and it came in today. And Alpha Brain helps support memory and focus. And he said it allowed him to be able to remember words that he had forgotten. And I don't think I've forgotten any words that I know. I just don't know very many words. So I don't think that I'm on top of that. But, you know, I'm giving this a shot because it's a nootropic formula, assists mental clarity, promotes flow state. And I like that. I think I can get it. So we're gonna test this on air. I've already taken the required dose, and we'll see how that works, see how it plays out. I will say something. Woo-hoo. I will say one thing, and this is no kidding. I do feel like an intensity here, and I'm not just kidding about that either. I'm not. So we'll see that how that works, see how the words just pop up, pop, pop, pop. They're already there. But you're going to see the studio get completely changed. Now, one of the problems that I'm having, which I'm having a lot, is getting out. It's been really getting extremely difficult. So that being said, how we're going to solve that problem is we're probably going to adjust the Lost Highway to a different day and probably go to, say, a Thursday, something like that. Because we are going to have to do a lot of stuff getting out for a lot of different stuff that we shoot. Probably is going to be on Saturday and Sunday. So I'll have a normal human being kind of life to a certain degree. And the only way we're going to do that, because it's just not working anymore. So that's not something I want to stop doing, and it's not something I am going to stop doing, but we might adjust Lost Highway to Thursday. Now, I won't know yet, but if I try to go out on a Saturday and I still got to write the show on Friday and Saturday, there's no time to put it together. And so we'll see how that works. One way or another, we're not stopping or quitting. We are just going to adjust the time and the date and see how that works. It may work good. You know, I did remember, you know, the other night I was on and I was thinking, you know, a lot of people that I know in Kansas City, I don't think any of them watch, but there's a lot of people in Kansas City. And I was like, you know, it's 11 o'clock there. And I was like, well, maybe there is some issues or problems. And so maybe we'll go back to, I even thought about doing a 7 o'clock, both shows, 7 o'clock, Tuesday and Thursday. And so we will work on that. We'll figure that out. I'll probably adjust that next week. And we'll see how it goes because I need to get out. There's locations that we need to find. There's secret locations we need to find. You know, what do you guys think about secret locations? I mean, I don't think there really is any secret locations, to be real honest with you. I'm not saying, you know, and then again, what's a secret location? How many people don't know? You know, what's a secret location? But where am I? The sign says Black Flag Expedition. You're there, but we'll figure it out. We'll find out, Don. I'm glad you're, hope you had a good week off, man. Hopefully, you had a great week off and I hope you did. Hope you had a great time. That be me. Okay. So who is going to be the character this week? Let's go ahead and get this going. Let's go ahead and stick this up here. Easy one. We got an easy one, okay? Ridiculously easy one this time, okay? Who dat be? Right there. Who dat be? Who dat be?
Who dat be?
Oh, good.
Dat be me.
Who is that character? That's an easy one. You should know. I mean, some of them I understand, but there's a lot of reasons why you should know who that is. Or vacation wore off on Monday at 8:10. Oh, so we will be doing some changes. We'll be doing some changes in the studio. We'll be getting back out and getting some fresh stuff done and be making some stuff happen. Probably most of the journeys will be going out on Saturday. That's probably going to be the definite day that we're going to go out and about. If some of you would like to join me, if some of you would like to invite me and you want to go some places, here's what I would like. Who would like to go to the Devil's Chasm? That's a must. There's two musts, okay? So anybody that wants, let's go, okay? Let's go. Devil Chasm and Skull Cave. Those are two that the Skull is going to be a little more difficult just because of the logistics. But then again, we have 800 more sites, and I'm not even kidding. There's 800 plus more sites. And so what we're going to talk about tonight a little bit is a location. There's Don Barry, going to need black light posters. We are going to need black light posters. We are definitely Mr. Barry.
Can it be? It is. Well, I'll be damned. That's Don Barry. Holy shit. You look good. I like that.
Boom, Mr. Barry, you look good. That's what Mr. Skeleton says, and I don't disagree with him. Tom, it is not Doc Holliday. It is not Doc Holliday. So that is the character that we are going to discuss tonight. And there's a whole series of stuff. There's a whole series of stuff that's coming up since I've been researching some of these people that roam around the Southwest and the state of Arizona. I fell into, and when somebody figures out who this is, we will discuss more what I found out about this not only secret, secret locations, but secret societies and secrets. There's a lot of secrets out there, and there really is a lot of secrets in the world. It's been going on for a long, long time. And we'll see. We'll see what's out there. So there was a location that an individual helped me find. And one of the things that got me extremely excited about any time that you're looking at Google Earth, because that's where it's at, right, is that snow trails. And that is really usually a good sign that there is no trails. And that's one of the cool parts, right? And the picture is so small. I don't know if I can make the picture any bigger. I don't know. No. Well, there's a reason why you should know this guy. There's two reasons why you should know this guy specifically. No, it is not Mark Twain, Mr. Larkins. It is not Mark. I'll just put it that way. It's not Mark Twain. But so one of the things that gets you excited when you do this is to try to slip into something that, and you know, I got told the coordinates to this location or the area, the general vicinity. I looked it up on, I didn't know exactly what was going to be there. I knew it'd be something. And so when I looked on Google Earth, and checked it out, I didn't know exactly where it was at. I knew it was in this vicinity. I didn't know exactly what I was looking for, but I knew it'd be cool. And so I went out searching for it. And again, the first thing I noticed was there were no trails. And that is so rare, it's not even funny. It is not even funny when you get locations and there's no trails going in. And it's not like a cliff ruin, right? It's not that area. So that's when it gets exciting to me, is when we go down that road. John D., sometimes it's not location that the secrets, is getting the location that the secret. There's truth to that, John D. There's truth to that. You know, and sometimes it's all a secret, and sometimes it is not. And so the trip that I like, now one thing I also noticed today, if you guys have not become aware of it, I will tell you this, there is 8 zillion snowbirds in town. I mean, all of a sudden today, driving down the road, I mean, people out walking, like couples together. And I'm like, I didn't see that all summer. So they've came out and they have got here. So the amount of people, and that's the only bad thing about a Saturday, is, man, you increase the amount of people that you're going to be dealing with for sure. And there's no doubt about that. So make sure that you give yourself plenty of time, because there is going to be a lot of people in the state of Arizona. And one of the things that we talk about when we talk about secret locations is, what's a secret really? You know, Dean posted a video on Sacred Mountain, and I'll bring him on to tell you guys how that worked out. And again, you're talking about a place that, I mean, people that don't know anywhere know where that's at. I mean, you know, there is, it's pretty funny. Now I understand. And then also, what makes a sensitive location? You know, is it, is there something there that, you know, is pristine, and that, you know, for me, for example, if I found a place that hadn't been dug, which I have not yet, I've not found one place of all the things that I've found, I've not found one place that hasn't been dug by pot hunters. I haven't found any, zero. And I know they're probably out there. It's going to be rare. You're going to be in southern Arizona. You're going to be along the border. You're going to be way out, you know, in between Yuma and Ajo and the Devil's Highway. You're going to be somewhere in those type of locations, I feel pretty confident, and or maybe north towards the border. But even up there, you're not going to. But it's rare. To find a location that has not been dug is going to be rare. But if you found one of those places, that's the one, that's the double secret one. You don't tell anybody, and you let somebody know that needs to be able to go dig it before somebody else gets in it. First thing that you need to do. I've never found one yet. Hopefully I will one day. Hopefully one day I'll stumble in one. There is, you know, in the southern border, there is 8 million caves. I mean, you can't see all of them. There's so many. So if there is a place down there, it would probably be in that location, would be what I'd suggest. Now, a lot of this stuff is just common sense. Nobody knows who that is. Okay. So we'll stop there and we will talk about that before we get onto the secret locations. If no one knows who that is.
In the Pioneer Cemetery in Phoenix, Arizona, is the gravesite of a Lord. Lord Dupa, a.k.a. Daryl Dupa. We're not so sure that he wasn't a self-appointed Lord at that, but he was an English gentleman born in France, educated at Cambridge University. When he came to Arizona, he traveled with an extensive library. He liked to spend time in bars quoting Shakespeare. And when he sat on top of the Pueblo Grande Hohokam ruin, he envisioned a new city coming up from the ashes of the old, and he called it Phoenix.
Boom, I'd done two other ones. I'd done another video on that. Now, what I thought was really cool is I dug into that. I didn't realize where he, you know, the end of the story. You know, that one picture was his house. It still stands. It's one of the oldest oldest buildings in Phoenix. And it still stands with no, and it shouldn't, and they're not doing anything with it, which is ridiculous, because this is a to me, it's a priceless part of our history that they need to do something with and let people know, because this is the dude that named the city of Phoenix and Tucson. So the story goes is that Dupa was on the top of the Pueblo Grande ruins. So he's standing on top of those ruins. And him and Swilling both. Now, Swilling was very well read. Dupa carried a library with him. He carried a library. And the guy was Cambridge educated. And how he ended up here, that's a whole nother story. But, oh, that's the best adult site. I was wondering which one that was. But now I know. So Dupa is standing on top of the Pueblo Grande ruin, looking out over this vast old ancient city, you know, that they're on top of, him and Swilling, and they were going to call Arizona Stonewall. That was one of the names. I think Sibley was another one. But they ended up Phoenix because of his education and the fact that he knew about Greece and things like that. And he was well-read, and supposedly Swilling takes some credit because it was his book, because he also carried a books and looked it up to make sure that Phoenix was the proper, the Phoenix Rising theory and thoughts, was accurate. So standing on top of that ruin, man, took a whole nother meaning to me, because I was like, holy crap. You know, here he is standing on top. And you have to remember, in Arizona, in Phoenix specifically, you know, we see this little ruin site, right? And the reality of it was, it's massive ruins all over the city of Phoenix. Again, ASU is built on ruins on both sides of the river. You know, so there was mass amounts of ruins on the other side. There was mass amount of ruins that they basically just, you know, leveled, basically. So it was massive. And the amount of, you know, and again, these are the people that built all the canals. This was all the structures that were built by these ancient people, you know, all these thousands of miles were the canals. You know, these guys came in and they... basically just, you know, repurposed it. It was all there. How can that be already? How could they already have another? I thought I had them. Maybe I didn't. Man, that must be the best adult site. That must be the best site, because it can't go away. Wow, it must be information we need to know. So, you know, that's what's so incredible about Dupa. And another thing that really got my intrigue as I was doing the research about Dupa was the fact that he was a Freemason, and how big these guys were and how much power they wielded and all these different groups. And you go into the Pioneer Cemetery and you go to all these cemeteries, whether it be anywhere, and all of a sudden, you know, you see these different sections. Everybody was a member of a group. Everybody was a part of one of these societies, right? And these societies wielded power, and it meant a lot. I mean, your ability to be able to do business a lot of times was dependent on that. We talked about the smoke eyes out of Prescott, and how if you weren't a member of the smoke eye, then you most likely were not going to be able to get the things that you needed to be a successful businessman, like building permits and things like that. And if you weren't a member of the smoke eye, you didn't get on the city council. And, you know, a lot of these groups, I don't think they started to go dark. They just, the power, it's like everything, all the history that we deal with, is usually a good plan, whether that's Chaco Canyon, for example. I don't think it started off horrible. It ended up that way. But what happened was, people get power, And then they get the elites, and then these people get elevated, and then all of a sudden they don't have to live their lives like everybody else does. So the Freemasons are something I'm really going to get involved in. You know, I know when you left some of these areas, like in Europe, and you got on the boat, you know, if you were a member when you went to New York City, you got a job on the dock. And if you weren't, then you didn't. And so there was a lot of that that went on. And you look at the amount of presidents that were Freemasons. It's unbelievable. And they also said that basically the layout of Phoenix, Arizona, he was a Freemason. Okay, so all these people were Freemasons, and that's only, and it's on his grave. So when I look at that kind of stuff and I look at the history, I found it fascinating, though, that he actually was standing in this ruin of this city, this massive city, that, you know, he was going to build this dream out of this ruin site. And wow, that puts a name, you know, the Phoenix name, it really enlightens it. Now, again, he would love to go to bars and quote Shakespeare, and he could quote Shakespeare off his memory. Now, I don't know if he was using Alpha Brain at that time, but I think he was using quite a bit of bourbon. And it might work just as well. It's hard for me to say. But that's what made it impressive to me, is that, you know, he named Tempe and he named Phoenix. And he did it by standing on that ruin, which now ties all this stuff into me, which makes it so cool. That's what makes history so awesome. And that's the secret, right? Sometimes the secret is just you don't know it, right? It's the secret because I don't know it. And I haven't learned yet. I've not been taught, or I have not found the research, but I found Dupa incredibly interesting dude. And I think he was a lunatic, which is okay. Swelling was definitely a lunatic. Swelling, but look, these guys were everywhere in the state of Arizona, and they are absolutely a fascinating history. And some of them it's bad history. Some of it is different. So we'll do another one next week, but that's my history spiel. Berman makes it work better. And it did. I think it did work better. There's no doubt in my mind. Hey, who am I to judge? Whatever works in a guy's life or a gal's life? That's not my job to worry about that. The bar is always open here, as we always say. We're not going to open it yet because we're not going to go full. Well, we're prepared if it needs to be. That doesn't mean, because I'm not officially opening the bar tonight, it does not mean that you can't partake in your own private bar, but as a channel, the bar is not open yet. So I got information on a site. I went out to that site on my own, and I hiked it, and a lot of information. When I watched the video back, I was like, you know, there's a lot of stuff, if you're getting ready to get out and do the deal, that we talk about a lot. And how to go out and how to adjust to what you need and be ready for whatever's happening. I go to some basic stuff if you're going to do this. Let's say you're from, I always use Ohio because I like Ohio, Chrissy Hines. So if you're not used to Arizona and this is a new world, the first lesson that I think anybody should find out here is that you're not in the Midwest anymore. If you're coming from one of those locations, drink water. I don't give a damn if it's 70. Take water with you and drink it. It will be your demise. And so I almost learned that lesson the hard way. So remember to drink water. And there's some pretty good tips. We won't go through it. We won't go through all of it. But we'll go through some of this video, and we'll get it started. And here we go.
Gonna guess where I'm at today. You can guess, but then I'd have to figure out where I'm at today. And we're on kind of our journey today. One thing you're going to notice about me today is I've got something that you're not going to see me carry too often. And that is a pack.
Miles, backpack. Can I get it for a dollar, backpack? Will it make me holler?
I don't take a pack too often. That's pretty rare. And I tell you what, the only reason I'm doing that today is we're hiking by ourselves. Now, you know, when I hike by myself, I'm going to do things a little different than I would if I was hiking with somebody. You know, I'm going to take a look around me. I'm going to get my formations of where I want or where I'm located. I know a direction where I'm going. And I'm also doing something else that's a little different also. And that is, I'm bushwhacking a mile .42. Now, how do I know it's a mile .42? Is I got these locations from a guy, and it's going to be an interesting journey today because, you know, when you just take off across the desert. Now, I have sent John my coordinates of where I'm going. He knows, I just talked to him a second ago, and he knows where I'm parked. And we're taking off on an adventure that's gonna be interesting. Now, what am I doing different? Well, you know, I have goods today. I have a 380 with me because I don't know what I'm gonna get into out here. Again, I'm bushwhacking. This is not trails. So who knows what kind of situations you could get into, but I'm not too worried. I've got about 24 reasons why not to be afraid. I've got plenty of water, and all I got is kind of a direction. But you know, that's what makes this cool, is that you don't really know where you're going. You know, you're out there and you're, I mean, look at this though. Now I will say this, for bushwhacking, this is about the easiest bushwhacking I think I've ever done. But what made me excited about this location was when I pinpointed on Google Maps is that there's no trails. And you know, if anybody knows anything about this stuff, if there's a lot of trails, you know, then you get stuff that's not as pristine and people have been, you know, climbing all over, stealing, whatever. But man, when you find one without any trail, you just, you know, you hope. And again, I don't know if this is going to be anything either. And I, you know, right now I've got really easy hiking, but who knows what you're going to come up against. You know, I'm not expecting to change across here, but you know, you just never know that. You know, if you're going to do a lot of stuff by yourself, I've had people ask, well, why don't you carry a pole, right? A hiking stick. And you know, most of the hiking sticks are big pieces of wood, and I don't want to haul a 2x4 around the desert. If you do that, there's nothing wrong with it. But if I decided I was going to use any type of, I'd use what I call sticks, which would be like ski poles, right? I would use those. Trekking poles is the proper name. Now, I would use trekking poles, but in a situation like this, I just don't see it necessary. I see it being a burden. And when you're trying to hike, you know, lighter's better. I can already tell that this is really getting dense in here, and it's going to probably be Chola fields and all kinds of stuff. Look back at where, you know, I'm looking back at, that's where, that's my points backwards, so I'll know that. I know where the sun is behind me. I know it's going to go here, and I know this is the direction I'm heading, and I know I've got 1.42 miles. So I got a pretty good idea, and you know, it's going to be non-straight hiking. I'm going to go through Chola fields, and that's one thing out here that I see is extremely. But man, I want to thank you for coming with me today, because here's deer coming through here. So we know we got wildlife. And also, what, when you're bushwhacking, you could come up against stuff that you normally wouldn't, because you know, they're thinking they're in the middle of nowhere too. So it's going to be an interesting journey to see, is there anything here? Now, I don't know, there's ruins in this area, but I'm excited to hike this because, again, I'm out here by myself. I'm in the middle of nowhere. I'm trucking through, And this is going to be a fascinating trip. So I'm going to give you a 360 of what you're seeing, what I'm seeing. Stay out of those cholas. And try to keep as straight a mark as I possibly can when I'm coming around here. Because I'm heading right there. Where I want to go is to the tip of that mountain range. And like I said, I know how far it is. It's a mile, 1.42 miles. And you know, how do I spend time, endless amount of time on Google. Google is just an incredible place to be able to look for stuff. You know, one of the most amazing things when you're out here, you'll see stuff and you'll go, wow, look at that. Look at that old bucket. Stainless. So stainless rust, right? For a minute I thought, you know, I'm also scouring the ground for arrowheads, shards, even though I don't think I'm going to find any out here. You just never know. So what do you think? I mean, what's your favorite hikes? What's the favorite hikes you've been on? What's an experience you had out in the desert that has really been special and important to you? I'll tell you, Perry Mesa was just it's still drawing me back. We're going to try to go again this week because that supernova has got me possessed. And it's just incredible to even think that that stuff's out here. And I can't wait. But you know, today's journey is awesome in itself because, you know, I'm just getting to be out here. You know, you're out here by yourself with your thoughts, you know, thinking about, you know, life. And I mean, we all got the same problems and situations, but we all got the same solutions too, you know? You know, and, you know, 2020 can be a great year, it can be a bad year. What are you going to make it? You know, what control do I have? Well, definitely, it's easy to keep a good positivity when you're out hiking in the desert and you just look at the beauty around you. I'm going to do this real quick just to kind of show you what I'm in. It's how far I've come. I'd say 0.6 if I had to gauge it, which is going to put me now a little less than a mile. And I mean, look at this cactus. Look how beautiful that is. That's just incredible. And they're just so, you know, every one of them is like a handprint. They're just totally different than the next. And it really is just incredible, you know, to be out in here. And every cactus, so look at these arms here and then those arms there. And, you know, they all have their unique styles. And so I had my first oh shit moment. You know, I saw this beautiful hawk and I was going to get a picture of him. He was just hovering above me. And man, I run into a steer out here. And I startled him and he startled me. And yeah, I'd have to say I jumped a little bit because all I seen was a brown flash. And I was like, oh, here we go. Now, if you look right up there on that very peak, that's pretty cool right there. As we come up on the site, you know, we're about 150, 200 yards out of where I believe the location is. What this tells me right here is this. Got a major flow of water at one time. May not be today, but look at this. Look at the size of this creek bed. It's one of the bigger ones I've seen out here, which means to me simply, but it had water. So this could sustain a group of people, which gets me excited because then I'm like automatically like, okay, so we have something over here. Now, the next thing, what am I looking for? Looking for petroglyphs. I'm scouring the ground, I'm scouring the sky, I'm scouring the mountain. Do I see petroglyphs? Because that's gonna be my bonus, right? That's gonna be my home run ball. So that's sucking me in. I don't see any petroglyphs yet. So, but here is an oddball formed rock on top of a rock. So I'm gonna do something I normally don't do, which is stupid, but because I'm by myself for some stupid reason. Banana, right? So what else do I got right here? You know? Right? And so I'm juicing up. I got my Tibetan prayer cloth. Backpack! Which is really my daughter's backpack from volleyball, which is a really good backpack, but you know, I didn't want to cut all the ribbons off, so I'm gonna have to go pink. Go pink or go home, as they say. You know, as I stopped to eat my apple and I came around the corner, I was like, boom, there we go. There's something right there. I can't tell, it's one's a warrior on the left. I'll get up close. That's pretty cool. There's one right there. So now we know, okay, at least we're in the area. We're in the area, which is absolutely killer. That there, what we saw something, right? So we know they were in this area, at least. You know, I just climbed up this ridge, so you're seeing what I'm seeing right here. And, you know, as we do this, you know, kind of let you know our thought process, okay? So I have an area which I believe to be an ancient site. I don't know if it's ruins. I don't know if it's a campsite. I don't know if it's petroglyphs. And it could be a combination of all of those. So where the petroglyphs, or where the marking was, let's go back. Where the markings were are right down there in that barren area right there. Now that could have been an encampment. And it also looks like a ditch runs, if you can see, right along that, which would be a perfect place to have an encampment. Now look how it's all worn out from everywhere else. You know, even in the most dense areas like over here, it's not like there. Like for years, you know, hundreds and hundreds of years, it got worn out. There's another location that's pretty barren that looks kind of,
you know, I'm going to stop it here in the halfway, just to let you know real quick, is that, so when you're looking at those areas, there's two things. It's pretty simple. This is not as complicated as a lot of people try to make it. If there was a stream or water somewhere within any valley, I don't care where it's at. You can look at where I was at and you can go 20, 50, 60 miles the other way. And if you find creek beds and then you find structures that are higher, right? Higher than the area around. Two different reasons. My first reason is it gave them a view of anybody coming so they weren't going to get snuck up on, right? And then second is they're closer to God. It's almost like to their spirituality, right? They're on a mound to some degree, a natural mound. So anytime you're out in these areas and you don't even know if there's ruined sites or things there anyway, you can almost go 50% that if you're going by a stream and ancient exploring, what's going on, man? I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you made it in. Thanks, Eric. And so it's really pretty simple. And it's more, you know, a lot of times the secret is not, the secret is you just, when you understand it, it's not a secret. When you get where you can look at ruin sites and you can see them and you see the clumps of grass and you see the clumps, because all ruin sites have this look of how the vegetation grows out, you automatically know what it is. When you get on Google Earth, you get used to seeing them. There's a couple guys on this side panel that are a hell of a lot better at Google Earth than I am, but you get a feel for where this stuff's at. And then all of a sudden, what you thought was secret, it's not really secret. I mean, it really isn't. Now, that's not to say there's not these specific places, but if there was water, if there was flow of water and you walk it, you're going to find stuff. You're just all over the state of Arizona. And again, when we talked about Lord Dupa, he's standing on the Pueblo Grande ruins. That was a massive site, and it was all through the valley. It wasn't just there. It was all over. We get this thought process that it was only here. But just like that map on that overlay we did the other week, there's probably stuff that's not even on that overlay that's out there that if you walked it, you would stumble into. And so, you know, when you go into that kind of stuff, you know, and you look for that stuff, if you know where to look and what you're looking at. Now, where a archaeologist or somebody trained a lot better than I am, they see things and they understand, you know, there's certain signs and certain style of rocks, and you can tell this is where they chipped and things like that. They have a lot more knowledge and it's easier for them to verify the location, but still they're going to be by water. They're going to be by water. If they're in a period where they're afraid, they're going to be up high. And even if they're on the plains, they're going to be at the highest location they can get to so they can see what's coming. so they can protect themselves. They're always looking to have forces come through their area. And one of the funny things about this video is even though I'm out there, I run into a guy hunting, and I don't know if I scared him or he scared me. But you know, and it's the second time in that area I've run into hunters. And so, you know, you need to be careful when you're out there too, and make sure that you're wearing, stuff that you can see, because again, you know, think of the fact that when you're hunting, if you're at Agua Fria at certain times of the year, think about the fact that you probably want orange on. I know it sounds silly to a certain degree, but do not be afraid, because we're not doing stuff that we don't want to be seen. So let them make sure that that you get seen out there, so you don't stumble into the wrong person. That cow about gave me a heart attack, man. And that's not the first time I've done that. At the ranch, I've done it too. Because they'll lay in the weeds, and all of a sudden, man, you'll scare them, and then they come out, and you're like, oh my God, it will take you. Orange is good. I bet hiking alone gives you more of an awareness of where those places might be. You know, the problem when the cool thing is when you got people with you, you're talking about stuff that you like to do together, and you're having these conversations, and the conversations are awesome. Don't get me wrong. I love that. But when you're by yourself, you are hyper-focused on what you're looking for, because that you have one goal, and that is to go find that stuff. And I've known people that specifically hike by themselves, and they love to do it. I have friends that do that. I would still prefer to have somebody, just because it's safer, you know. And here's the other thing. The selfish part is that if you're looking for something, you don't know exactly where it is, you can split. And then you can, and then you got two people looking for it. So you got a better opportunity to find it, and you just got another set of eyeballs, and that's what makes it, good as well. I don't know if Dean's ready in here or not. I wanted to talk to him about a secret location. So if Dean is ready, I want to talk about his secret location and what went down on at his secret location we talked about, and see how it went down and what went that way, because I want to pull him in here and see. Let's pull him in. I want to see about what happened to him. Dean, what's up?
What's going on?
Secret locations. I heard you got a secret location.
I do. Do you have a... Do you have a echo? Because I have a horrible echo on this guy.
You know, nobody said anything because they couldn't. So what I can do is get in here, and I have to set this thing off a couple different ways. Cool. There we go. I guarantee you I just fixed it.
Yeah, you did. You did.
So somebody tell me that. There's Ernest Hubble with the two tomatoes. That's what Ernest does. He carries the two tomatoes. So you know a secret location.
Yeah, you mentioned that. I jumped in just before when you were mentioning it, but it is, of course, Sacred Mountain out there at exit 298 out there by the V-Bar V Ranch. And I've posted it to TikTok a few times, because I've said to you in the past, I've actually had people email me from just outside the V-Bar V Ranch saying, look, we traveled an hour and a half to get to this location. We still can't find it. And I've done my best on other videos to give people the information and the right directions. But so I did it a little bit better this time around, where I gave you the almost exact location. I mean, if you can't find it off the last TikTok video, you just don't need to go out there and look for it. But man, I posted it, and it was one of those that got 100,000 views. So I knew it was coming. And the comment section was just getting outrageous. To the people that I was putting out this sacred site, that I'm a blankety blank for doing so. And, all these, I left them all out there, but, I don't normally answer people like this, because, you know, it takes a little bit of brain power. But, first of all, like you've said, this is not a secret location. When you go up there, and I've put this on the video, when you go halfway up, there's a sign there. There's actually a sign on the trail that tells all about the location. And then it also gives you you know, what's going to happen to you if you take anything, the fine, and how many years in prison you're going to spend if you take anything off of the top of that that little butte there. And then I always tell people the only way that I found out about it is if they watched the V-Bar V Ranch that I did about 2.5 years ago during their presentation. And that's a national heritage site. So they're very protective of everything. And they're very protective of that small little grouping of petroglyphs that they got at the V-Bar V site that you had to walk a little over a mile to get to. But they are the ones that showed people the butte of where they these people used to live, and that we call it Sacred Mountain, and we don't know what they called it, of course. And he said, nobody raised their hand. It was about 25 people in the audience when he was giving his presentation, and I was there. And he said, if you want to go, I'm obliged to tell you that anybody can go up there and check it out. The only caveat that he gave, he didn't say don't touch anything. He didn't say, you know, you're going to prison for a year if you take something out of there. He didn't say be careful while you were up there. The only thing that he was obligated to say as a national heritage site is watch out because there's a lot of rattlesnakes up there. And that would have gotten, if I would have said something like that on the TikTok, people would have went outraged because I didn't tell them. I'm responsible for telling people don't touch anything up there. But it's a site that it's like Toosie Goot for crying out loud. It's a site where everybody knows about, especially in the Sedona Verde Valley area. And what I think it comes down to is it's a little bit snobbish for the people in the Verde Valley, Sedona area for more people not to know about this place. And I can say I've been out there at least 3 times, and they all have been within 6 months to a year apart from each other. And I swear the last time I was up there, it was cleaner than the first time I went up there. So this BS about people going up there and doing horrible things to the site is absolutely ridiculous. And the reason I don't think they do horrible things to the site is because a lot of people know about it. And a lot of people have eyes on it. So you can't go up there and do something stupid because you're probably going to come down that hill and you're going to pass somebody. And I can guarantee, I haven't seen them up there yet, but I can guarantee there are those little animal cameras somewhere placed around that trail to mark everybody that's gone up and come down. So they've got your picture, they've got your video. So it just amazed me at the garbage I was getting online about people thinking this is such a sacred site that nobody needs to know about it or go up to it.
Well, the people that name these everything, right? So look, I don't care if it's a group of people, you know, I don't care, you know, if they've got named by people that, you know, not the people that were the people, right? A different group of people named these people, right? And so all these names, Sacred Mountain, dude, there's no indication it was a sacred, it was or it wasn't, right? So when they hear that name, they think automatically, oh my God, you know, it's sacred. And the people thought it was sacred at one time. The hell, they're all sacred and they're all not sacred. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Just tell them for every person that cries, you'll make another TikTok or another site around there.
Hey, look. I mean, Ryan, I'm not one to answer this crud. I'm not one to go into it, but I started putting emojis of laughing with, you know, the tears coming out. And the more I did that, the more the people got heated, saying I didn't know about protecting these sites. I didn't know what I was doing. It's crazy because truly and honestly, I'm a speck on all the sands of the seashore on TikTok. You know, to me, I have a lot of followers. To me, I get a lot of looks. But they think that when I post something, it's gonna bring you know fire and brimstone down from heaven upon that butte, and it's gonna be totally destroyed within 24 hours of me posting something. So I'm glad they give me that kind of credit, but it gets ridiculous. It's like posting Toosie Goot or Montezuma's castle or something like that, and people putting ignorant stuff like that out there. When you would post something like that, it just takes a little bit more effort to get to Sacred Mountain. And it does. It requires a 1 mile hike from your car. And the trip up the side of the butte thing is not easy. It's a small little path with cactus all over the place. And it's full of bees halfway up. And it's a journey to get to the top of it. But it's not that rough. But I mean, for most people, the reason they don't know about it and they live in Sedona or the Verde Valley is because they don't try to get out there to it. All they want to do is pick, you know, Jeff's videos apart, my videos apart, or anybody who posts anything on a sacred spot. Again, it's called Sacred Mountain. We did that in the late 20th century. We called it that. Even the people at the heritage site says, hey, you know, in 19 something something, we called it Sacred Mountain. Who knows? We call them the Sanagua. Well, obviously they weren't called that either. So or, it's just, it becomes stupidity. That's all it is.
Well, you know, and that's what's funny about the whole deal. Effort, 99% of the people who watch it will never go. That's you know, I don't think it's that high. I think it's more than 99.9. And you know, the thing is, it's like this video here. Yeah. You know, I didn't say anything there. You know, if you know the area, you know where I'm at. If you don't know the area, you don't know where I'm at. You know, if you got an idea, then you got an idea. But that's what's so funny about it. They throw these rocks and it's like, okay, where am I? Well, if you know the state of Arizona that well, to know where I'm at, then you already are way ahead of me. If you can look at a landscape like that and tell where I'm at, and some can, don't get me wrong, but those are the guys that, it's ridiculous is what it is. That's why I'm a fan of leaving roads unimproved. And you know, I am too. I love what they've done. I love Agua Fria because it is as it is. You get what you get. You're going to get a road. It's going to suck. And if you want to go, then you're going to have to do the work to get there. And then when you get there, you're going to have to do the work to find it. And those aren't the people that are going to tear the stuff up. They're just not. They can't separate the problem from, you know, they can't separate it because they're not smart enough to understand that there's two groups of people here, you know, and the ones that are going to just stumble on it. And they've had problems in the area, in that area before. I know they have. And the biggest problem they've had is because they didn't take care of it. They didn't fix it when they could have. They continue to let people drive around in that area ridiculously when they should. Now, you know, they should have been able to. You gate it off. And when I say gate, you have an opening to walk through, but you make people walk, you know, half mile. And nobody has a problem with that wants to see it. Right. And you get people that are driving drive-bys and it is that guess. Ryan, I'll tell you where it's at, but it's not either one of those places, believe it or not. But, there's not too many places that people on this channel that I personally know, we share coordinates. We do. And we should. And that's what this is about. It's about, you know, but it's not everybody, you know, and there's places that I wouldn't tell. There's places I wouldn't tell people, you know, there's still a small core group of people that I would. So don't get me wrong, but I wouldn't as a whole, we wouldn't blast it out of the channel. We never have. We get accused of it. Is that's what's so, and I can't even find my videos because they're not labeled like they would be if you were hunting them down. I can't even find them. So I don't know how the hell else somebody else is.
Yeah. I mean, there's a difference in the places that you're going out in the wilderness there and finding and not putting out there. And then there's national heritage sites, national monument sites and everything like that. That, I mean, the only reason that's the only one I've ever done, and I've done it three times now. Shown people to the best of my ability, because the question was asked numerous times, where is it at? And it's again, it's opened to the public. It's not a secret. It'd be like the White Mountain area that I went to, the Petroglyph Trail that's out there, telling you that that's some kind of secret place. And that's got some of the most petroglyphs almost I've ever seen in my life. Up when you're walking up that path, half of it is nice and paved for the people. You can actually take somebody in a wheelchair halfway up that path, but there are more petroglyphs there than you. They're everywhere. But hold on, what's up, buddy?
Prayers.
Okay, I'll be right there. Okay.
You see, by Jesus, who is ever Lord to be praised.
Okay, I'll be right there. All right. Right. All right. Give me 1 second, Jeff. I'll be right back.
You know, the thing about it, this whole deal is that I had people call me on the phone and ask me, man, I'm out here now. I'm lost. And I've been that guy. I've called people. And I don't have a problem with it. If I'm out there and I think I know a guy that knows where it's at and I'm in the middle of nowhere and I'm, you know, I still got cell service, I do not have an issue calling somebody out and getting the coordinates because I'm out in the middle of nowhere. I don't have an issue with it. And I don't have an issue when people call me. Happened 2 days ago, 3 days ago. And I was more than happy to help a fellow adventurer out. I knew him though. It's a whole different deal too, that you know him, right? You know these people. And when you know these people and you can trust these people, why wouldn't you help them? You know, you do. I'm just upset because I have missing teeth. Well, the Chaco people did the original Washington wooden teeth, I think, and they replaced them with wood teeth. So that's where we kind of laid that out. While we're waiting and Dean's got to take care of some business, let me pop this video back in and let's get it back going.
Now again, I wouldn't probably look at those if I didn't know that there was supposedly something over here. Now I'm up on this hill saying that this was where the Warriors were or the Warriors stayed. You know, I don't know. It's kind of funny that that's just there by itself. You know, oh, there's another guy up there. Okay, so there's a couple. There's another one. So let's take a look at that real quick. And, you know, maybe this was the locust. And I don't want to. And, you know, I've been seeing tracks all over here. But again, it goes. It's going to force me to drive another. And I don't want to. And, you know, I've been. They're just off on the coordinates. But there is. All different sites, right? And then you get a marker that you go, okay, I know that marker. I know what that marker means, even though it's probably. It's gone, and what it used to say, okay, right here. Now, maybe that's a landmarker, but man, if it is, that's old. Wow, look at that. So that actually might be a landmarker, but I looked at this land next to us, and I said, you know what? This is a dig right here. So this is a dig. So whether I'm right or wrong, I'm telling you, this is what I believe right here. This is the dig location right in here. That is what I'm believing. There was the mountains we were at where we saw the glyphs. So this all makes sense. They would have been close. So this is what I believe to be the campgrounds, and it looks like it. That's definitely a scratch right there. You know, I can't, but I do believe truly that if there was something up here, there would have been something up here to indicate it. They'd have been up on this somehow. So you're looking with me, seeing if we're seeing anything up there. Would indicate that this point would have had some significance. You know, they used a lot of these little areas. I call them islands, even though, you know, they're not islands, definitely. But I call them islands. And it seemed like they always encamped either on points or on these little islands, especially in this location. And there's exactly what I was looking for. Okay, here we are. There it is, right there. Okay, so now I'm happy. There we are. We have found what we're looking for. There it is. That one panel is indicating to me that we are where we're supposed to be. So we now have to circle it, and then we now have to go on the top of it. How neat is this? There's where we came from, over that direction. There we are. Wow, look at this. Here we are, right up on this point. Okay, I am beyond stoked now. I'm beyond stoked. Look at that mark. Now, look at this mortars up here. This is crazy. So here we are, look at this. Look at this rocks on this point. And no, okay, here's the funny thing. Okay, look at this. They stole that. This location, is absolutely, I mean, I would have thought they would have put more, you know, somebody walked down this hill. There's another one over here, right there. Let's get over here where I get out of the sun. This whole rock, look at there, look at that. Oh man, this is awesome. Now this is awesome, look at this. And this, nobody's been down here. This is so pristine. Nobody's been along this area. That's what I'm walking on to see if you can see what I've got. Look at that. That is beautiful. That is beautiful. Wow. Looky there also. Look at that. Look at that hole. Oh, man. Oh, man. This is so cool. You know, I had to walk all that valley to get where I already am, right? Which is here. But the fact that I found it, look at my man right there. Wow, those are beautiful. Those are absolutely, you know, I guess finding them also when you didn't see any is the biggest thrill as anything. It's because, you know, you didn't know where you were at. You didn't know you're in the right location. And you're getting ready to come home. And then you see these. And, you know, it's not been, you know, this area here, you can tell it's not had a lot of people. You know, there's no tracks, there's no footprints, there's no nothing over here. Which is, man, I already knew that there wasn't a road in here. So, well, I am stoked. I couldn't be happier with this point. Even though, you know, they may not have been loaded, but they were there. They're absolutely there. Just like I'd hoped them to be. Oh man, how cool is that? That is so cool. I don't know if you can tell, but I am pumped up. This is unreal. I'm so excited. There's another one there that if I had a de-stretcher, I could pull out of there. So that'll be the next thing I get is a de-stretcher. But I am stoked. After this, man, I am stoked. I'm stoked. It's been a pretty cool journey today. And you got to see it as soon as I saw it, which is pretty cool. It really is. And hopefully you enjoyed this day today. Hopefully you had a fun time. Hopefully it was a neat experience getting to get out here. You know, thank God we didn't get shot or hit with an arrow.